Hello, and thank you for joining us as we continue the historic Artist Homes and Studios virtual road trip. We have been on an amazing journey so far, and today we'll explore one of the historic Artist Homes and Studios' newest member sites, the Noah Purifoy Desert Art Museum of Assemblage Art, as the fifth stop on this year's virtual road trip. This virtual road trip is a collaboration between the James Castle House in Boise, Idaho, and the Historic Artist Homes and Studios program, also referred to as HAHS. We launched this presentation last year in response to the recently published Guide to Historic Artist Homes and Studios, written by Valerie Belint, the director of HAHS. With a desire to dig deeper into these incredible sites, this virtual road trip was born. So for those of you just learning about HAHS, this is a program of the National Trust for Historic Preservation. HAHS is a coalition of 55 sites across 25 states that were previously the homes and working studios of many American artists. HAHS aims to preserve the nation's legacy of creativity in the visual arts by connecting visitors with these remarkable spaces. So my name is Mackenzie Dunstan, and I'm the Education and Outreach Coordinator at the James Castle House in Boise, which is located on the ancestral and unceded territory of the Shoshone, Bannock, and Northern Paiute people. And as your unofficial stop on this year's virtual road trip, I would encourage you to learn more about our museum in Boise. With me today is Valerie Belint, who is the director of HAHS, and Joseph Lewis, who is the president of the Noah Purifoy Foundation and a professor of art at the University of California, Irvine. Providing American Sign Language interpretation is Peter Buckland. Along with ASL interpretation and English language, along with ASL interpretation, we also have English language captions that are available by clicking on the live transcript button at the bottom of your screen and selecting show subtitle. So live transcript and then show subtitle. We strongly encourage your questions, and you can send all your questions and thoughts and comments to us through the Q&A box, and we will answer as many as we can at the end of today's presentation. This event is being recorded and will be made available online. So at the end of this presentation, I will share links to related events, resources, videos, mailing lists, everything you could want based on today's presentation. So because this is a virtual road trip, I'd like to offer a few travel notes for us to consider before we get started. If we can look at our map, please. So last month, we visited the Georgia O'Keeffe Home and Studio in Abiquiú, New Mexico. Now, the journey between Abiquiú and the Noah Purifoy Desert Art Museum, located in Joshua Tree, California, is about 750 miles and follows historic Route 66. We recommend you plan at least 3 days of travel for this leg of the trip if you were to do it in real life. So heading west from Abiquiú, we're first going to stop in the Petrified Forest National Park, which is in northern Arizona. You can take a scenic drive through the park or get out of your car and wander the colorful trails of the Blue Mesa, Painted Desert, or even the Rainbow Forest of Petrified Wood. If you're wanting a little more history to go with this stunning landscape, you can learn about the long human history and even longer geological history of the area by joining a ranger-led tour to explore specific sites located around the park. So although not open to the public yet, I did want to mention a really cool space called the Roden Crater, which is an unprecedented large-scale artwork created within a volcanic cinder cone by artist James Terrell that you would actually pass by as you head westward. So with its anticipated opening, hopefully in 2024, this four decades long project will be a site that encourages visitors to reflect on time, space, light, and existence. Continuing to Flagstaff, you can still contemplate your place in the universe by visiting the Lowell Observatory. Home to one of the most versatile telescopes in the world, the Lowell Discovery Telescope, this observatory is also the first place where humans spotted Pluto in 1930. Enjoy the GeoVail open deck at the observatory, which is a state-of-the-art observing plaza where there are six powerful telescopes available just for visitor use. So after you've gazed into the heavens for a while, come back down to earth and enjoy some music and dancing at Flagstaff's Museum Club, locally known as the Zoo. This is a large 1930s log cabin that began as a taxidermy museum, but has since been transformed into a popular music venue, dance hall, and saloon. So we're finally at the California border, and there's much to see when you finally cross state lines. So before we reach our final destination, I'd like to invite Valerie to share some of her recommendations when traveling in the area.
Thank you, Mackenzie, to you and everyone involved at the James Castle House for spearheading this virtual road trip in collaboration with Historic Artists Homes and Studios. I am excited to have us continue this year's series with an artist whose life practice and commitment to community reminds us of the transformational power that art can have on larger society. I first learned about Noah Purifoy when I attended a conference presentation given by our speaker this afternoon, Joseph Lewis, longtime president of the Noah Purifoy Foundation. And that very day, I became determined to have this singular artist-designed environment Purifoy created in Joshua Tree become a site of HAHS, which I am happy to say became a reality this year. But what you will learn today is that this site is only one touchstone to a fascinating creative whose inspiring narrative and impact have yet to be fully celebrated in larger public consciousness. It's my hope that HAHS can play a small part in advancing that. One connecting point, which you can include in part of your Purifoy journey, can be found by visiting another artist environment, Watts Tower in Los Angeles, and then embarking on a 3+ hour drive east to Joshua Tree. This collection of soaring interconnected towers, all built over a period of 3 decades by Italian immigrant Sabato Simon Rodea, has transcended into popular culture, as this image from the Simpsons cartoon attests. And hopefully this site will be a future HAHS member as well. Later, Noah Purifoy served as the co-founder of the adjacent Watts Tower Art Center, which still exists today. And Joe will guide us through the details of this story. I thank him and his colleague, Chris Ogata, for suggesting that we host this virtual journey today, on the very anniversary of Purifoy's birthday, a fitting celebration for this teacher, community activist, and artist, and compelling human being. Next slide, please, Joe. In terms of your own Purifoy excursion, while a stop in LA is worthwhile, flying into Palm Springs is also a great itinerary and puts you about an hour southwest of the site. This cosmopolitan oasis is perhaps best known for its mid-century modern architecture, soothing hot springs, and stunning landscapes. While wine tastings, world-class spas, chic shops, and amazing golf courses abound here, there are other more adventurous undertakings also on offer. Perhaps consider taking the aerial tramway, which lifts you more than 8,000 feet above sea level to the top of the San Jacinto Peak. As I know personally from living in California, one of the highlights of driving from LA to Palm Springs is taking in the majestic field of wind turbines. So upon your arrival, you can join an educational tour in Palm Springs of one of the earliest windmill farms in the nation. Make sure, of course, to also visit the Palm Springs Art Museum, which boasts strong collections of both Native American and pre-Columbian art, as well as works by fellow HAHS artists, like Thomas Moran's Grand Canyon and Charlie Russell's Roping a Prairie Wolf, both seen on screen. Along with rotating exhibitions, a 4-acre sculpture garden awaits. Next slide, please, Jim. Palm Springs is the principal city of the Coachella Valley, along a string of desert towns in this region of Southern California. If you travel in April, make a plan to attend the Coachella Festival at the Empire Polo Club. This intersection of music, art installation, and self-expression through fashion is for the young at heart and not just for the young. Camp out on site, discover emerging artists, or wax nostalgic as you experience one of the many and popular band reunion tours, all alongside some of Hollywood's most famous glitterati. Next slide, please, Joe. One of the most luxurious indulgences of traveling by road through Southern California is taking advantage of the many agricultural delicacies grown here. citrus, of course, but avocados, pistachios, figs, olives, and dates. About an hour south of the site, take a personal tour with Sam Cobb, owner of the family orchard with boats, grows seven varieties of dates. Meander among these majestic trees, which take 10 to 14 years to mature, and leave with 16 ounces of yummy, yummy dates, gratis of the farm. Next slide, please. Finding a sea in the middle of the sweeping desert might seem like a mirage, but the Salton Sea is a massive, intriguing body of water, a huge man-made lake just east of Greater Palm Springs. Touring the 115 miles of shoreline makes a fascinating day trip. Discovered varied attractions from remnants of its glory days as a Hollywood playground to the spectacular migrating birds that break the stillness of the water in the nature preserve. Other singular features await, from bubbling mud pots to salt marshes to an actual banana museum featuring 20,000 related items. Treat yourself there to a banana split if you haven't already indulged in too many dates along the way. Next slide, please. Along Salton's western edge, stop at the fantastical world, an estate originally owned by the heir to the Avery Label fortune. Picnic, horseback ride, bike, and hike among, or just marvel at the more than 130 large metal sculptures that punctuate this unfenced landscape. From the T-Rex and giant scorpion to graceful rearing horses to a 350-foot-long dragon, these creatures all cohabitate in a wonderland of completely upended scale and perspective. Next slide, please. Along Salton's east shore, a place of artistic pilgrimage beckons. Adjacent to Slab City, the well-known commune for those who enjoy life off the grid, Salvation Mountain arises in all its colorful splendor. For more than 30 years, Leonard Knight labored to produce this sprawling visionary art environment. A highlight of any experience here is witnessing the vast array of potent personal mementos visitors have added to Knight's own magnum opus. We hope someday to also have this as part of the HAHS family. Next slide. Getting closer to our final destination, Joshua Tree boasts its own artistic enclave, an intriguing collection of hotspots. Just 9 minutes from the site, step into an old photo processing booth converted into a haven for, of all things, crochet. Close by, an equally enticing beauty bubble, part vintage salon, part thrift store, and part museum with more than 3,000 pieces of hair and beauty memorabilia. You can even reserve an actual hairstyling appointment with the owner and curator. Next slide. No trip to this region is complete without a visit to Joshua Tree National Park. If you enter these 800,000 acres from the west, you can stop by First World, a spaceship-like performance space and art installation featuring concerts and film screenings, or go sound bathing and lie amidst 20 quartz crystal singing bowls all playing simultaneously for your pleasure and healing. Both experiences are in nearby Landers. Once inside one of the world's most famous natural wonders, the iconic Bristol trees that are the namesake await, but so do rugged rock formations and stark landscapes dotted with cacti. Be prepared. Though beautiful, the desert environment can be harsh and unforgiving. Have enough water, be aware that there is no cell service, and you must have your own working vehicle. There are no shuttles within this park. Next slide. Your trip culminates where natural wonder of the California desert meets the man-made wonder of artistic imagination, Noah Purifoy's environment. The achievement of a creative who is constantly evolving and began a new chapter when he was in his 70s. Here, Purifoy transferred his practice outdoors, in essence, using the very desert floor itself as the studio. This powerful place breaks with ideas of conventional studio space and media altogether, and its acceptance into HAHS beautifully represents our vision to redefine traditional paradigms of what an artist's home and studio can be. This afternoon, we are privileged to be guided by someone who has a longstanding and deeply personal connection to both this artist and this site. I thank you, Joe, for being the conduit into Noah's captivating world. And thank you, as always, Mackenzie, for your partnership on this collaborative event.
Thank you so much, Valerie. I always love hearing your travel notes. It makes me want to go visit all these places and spend multiple weeks just in those locations. So now onto the main event. I will pass this off to Joe, who will tell us more about Noah Purifoy and this truly incredible site.
Thank you, Mackenzie, and thank you, Valerie, in particular for inviting the Noah Purifoy Outdoor Desert Museum of Assemblage Art into the HAHS family. We're really excited to join this, you know, illustrious group of artists, homes, and studios. Before we begin, Noah Purifoy Foundation would like to acknowledge the ancestral and cultural unceded territory of the Serrano. Historically, these indigenous people lived mainly in the San Bernardino Mountains and the Southern Mojave Desert of California. The site is located in the San Manuel Band of Mission Indians area, whose traditional name is the Yahevatan, or People of the Pines. We recognize and honor their elders and celebrate their current vitality and that of their future generations. The Noah Purifoy Desert Art Museum of Assemblage Art is located at 63030 Blair Lane, Joshua Tree, California, and is open to the public free of charge 365 days a year from sunrise to sunset. When you visit, please sign in at the welcome kiosk, which also contains a self-guided tour material. Please, groups of 10 or more must make arrangements prior to coming to the site. Well-behaved dogs are welcome as long as they are leashed and constantly monitored, especially picking up after them. Donations are graciously accepted. If you want more information, please go to noahpurifoyoneword.com. Please note, there are no restroom facilities at the site. The foundation also offers docent-led tours to the general public. Docent-guided tours for schools and museum groups may be arranged in advance by reservation. For more information, please contact the foundation at noahpurifoyfdn@gmail.com or go directly to our website. I make art. I do not do maintenance, Noah Purifoy. We make a foundation, now we do maintenance. Sue Welsh, co-founder of Noah Purifoy Foundation. It's not difficult to understand the depth and breadth of these two quotes when you're standing on Blair Lane and Joshua Tree, looking over the 100 or so works from monumental to human scale built by Noah during the 16-year residency he had there that populates the 10-acre site. Also, the immense challenges faced by the foundation as well. Sometimes you can feel Noah's presence working in seamless collaboration with the robust environment of the high desert and his off-sited partner in the creative process. In 1989, Noah was 72 years old when he moved to the desert, and he lived and worked until his passing in 2004. And today would have been his 105th birthday. Artist, theorist, and community activist Noah Purifoy was an anomaly in the art world, coming to art making late in life with a passion and vision whose contributions and sizable cultural imprint are just receiving the attention they deserve in an art world long in the tooth, but short in diversity. Noah's life story is just as rugged as the Mojave Desert territory he eventually changed with his art. Born in 1917 into a sharecropping family at the height of Jim Crow in Snow Hill, Alabama, a town that has no national census data. His earliest memories were of trailing behind his parents and 12 siblings as the whole family worked hot and humid summer days picking cotton. He sought out higher education and in 1939 received a bachelor's degree from Alabama State Teachers College. He went on to teach industrial arts in high school and then enlisted in the Navy at the beginning of World War II as a CB. After the war, he returned to enroll in Atlanta University, now Clark Atlanta University, and received in 1948 a master's degree in social services administration, MSW. The photo on the right is a picture of Noah being celebrated by Atlanta University as Panther Patriots, alumni, faculty, and students whose historic contributions have distinguished them in the service to our nation. Eventually, applying his trade in Los Angeles as a social worker at the Los Angeles County Hospital from 1951 to 1956. Encumbered by race and social quicksand, Noah's curiosity and determination are worthy in and of themselves of multiple volumes. And just kind of think about being born in 1917 in the Deep South, becoming educated, in the height of Jim Crow and moving on across the country and winding up in Los Angeles. Disillusioned with social work, Noah left work one day and never to return. Went down the street and enrolled in Chouinard Art Institute, now called Cal Arts, becoming his first African-American student and received a BFA, his third degree, just shy of his 40th birthday. His involvement with the arts is multifarious. He was a maker and his work influenced the likes of David Hammons, John Oddbridge, Sangin Ngudi, just to name a few. John Riddle, an artist, says, Noah always shared whatever he knew or thought. I remember my first visit to Noah's apartment. He had made everything in the house, tables, chairs, wall-to-wall carpeting pieced together from carpet samples. And one of his first jobs after graduating from Chouinard was as a commercial industrial artist. And this is one of his pieces, a hi-fi set, that was shown at an exhibit called California Design in 1960. He also worked with John Smith, the first African-American to be accredited by the National Society of Interior Designers. This is a picture of Noah's apartment, and this is one of his industrial design projects, interior design projects. In 1963, Noah wrote in his notebook, I do not wish to be an artist. I only wish that art enables me to be. These words guide us, especially the educational emphasis of the Purifoy Foundation's Urban Arts Initiative, which we discussed a little later, to encourage students to find in Purifoy's philosophy of creativity place. Purifoy also said, there must be more to art than mere sensation. When we must be affected permanently for art of itself is of little or no value if in its relatedness, it does not affect change. In 1964, with Judson Powell here on the right, the two of them co-found the Watchtowers Art Center, where Noah served as its director through 1966. There he created in-school and after-school children's art programs with a focus on junk art, as well as special programs for school dropouts. By 66, a considerable number of his students had returned to high school, received their diplomas, and a few even went on to attend college. I think that's a very important point because as we see, you know, Noah, his idea of education, his idea of kind of the relationship between his artwork and society and community really meld at that point. Witnessing the traumatic events of police brutality and poverty in the community of Watts in August 1965 forced Noah to confront himself and his ideas about art. In Watts, he saw himself and his fellow artists as community activists who took part in the inaccessible high places into the street to let people touch art, be a part of it. Purifoy stated that the Watts Rebellion in 65 was the catalyst that changed his life and artistic vision, including his role as the founding director of the Watts Towers Art Center. Judson Powell and Noah, after the Watts Rebellion, collected 3,000 pounds of salvaged material, which served as the palette for his seminal collaborative exhibition, 66 Signs of Neon. 66 Signs of Neon existed on several levels as an art exhibition dominated by assemblage of artifacts in the Watts riots, as a one-to-one format of communication between individuals who otherwise would not communicate with each other, and as an evolving system of philosophy. It began as an expression of the necessity for art education, affirming the importance of this avenue of self-expression to individuals in the Watts community. What's also, you know, very interesting about this project is that it was intergenerational, multicultural in the sense that it had, you know, different ethnicities involved, and also had women involved in it too. It was a collaborative project. Purifoy and Powell began with six assemblage pieces created from the lead drippings of melted neon signs, artifacts of the riots. As their work continued, they recruited a diverse group of six additional professional artists skilled in plastic and graphic arts. In concert, the group set out to create 66 separate works of art for this project. In an incredibly brief period of time, 30 days, they labored literally night and day, groping through the glistening, twisted, grotesquely form materials, each interpreting in their own way the August happenings. 66 Signs of Neon was on the road from 1966 to 71, first installed at Markham Junior High School, where Sue Welsh, co-founder of the foundation, taught, and it was shown at Berkeley, eight other California state universities, Kalamazoo Institute of Art, the Huntington Gallery in Knoxville, as well as numerous other national venues and abroad. As Purifoy wrote in the catalog, we wish that there must be. Bitter, sweet, black, white, life and death. There must be therein a me and a you who is affected permanently. Art of itself is of little or no value if in this relatedness it does not affect change. We do not mean change in the physical appearance of things, but a change in the behavior of human beings. During the next 10 years or so, Noah works as an artist, teacher, and briefly returns to social work as the director of social services for the Central City Community Mental Health Center, which focused on psychological issues affecting the African-American community in Los Angeles. And that kind of melds really well with his, you know, art philosophy and the direction that he moves forward with. When Governor Jerry Brown looked across the state of California for critical leadership in establishing a state's art commission, he selected NOAA as a founding member in 1976, along with Peter Coyote and Gary Snyder, among others, to create the California Arts Council to address arts accessibility for the people of California. For 11 years, from 1976 to 1987, Purifoy made immense contributions to the organization's development, its thesis and its structures. And for most of that period, he was known as Mr. Minority for his emphasis on expanding access to funding to arts and organizations of color. His role as an artist, arts activist, and program developer is key to understanding California's evolution as a progressive cultural leader. Purifoy inaugurated several CAC programs, including Artists in Schools, Artists in Prisons, Artists in Communities, which were the first of its kind in the country. He took pride in utilizing millions of state art dollars to advance equity and opportunity for creative individuals and artistic organizations outside of the mainstream or of major entities. Purifoy brought firsthand experience to his work at the California Arts Council of what deprivation and exclusion from opportunity can cause. Though most people think that Purifoy did not make art during this period, we now call the practice of community interventions, authoring arts education programs, et cetera, as social practice. Furthermore, his ideas about the creative process, the intellectual glue that held all of his activities together, still need further annotating. After his tenure at California Arts Council, he returns to making work. And these are some pieces that he made from 87 to 89. And I think here you can see a well-developed kind of conceptual idea of melding disregarded materials into something new. This particular piece shows his, you know, kind of the high potency of his craft. All right, this is an aerial view of the site. It's 10 acres and it kind of, it goes from here to here to here and here. In 1989, with scant resources that would not sustain a creative life in Los Angeles, NOAA looked for a new place to set roots. He had considered Cali Mesa, which is southwest of Joshua Tree, but at the invitation of Debbie Brewer, who was one of the people, one of the artists who was involved in 66 Signs of Neon, she invited him to stay in her son's trailer. This is a view of, here's NOAA over here. This is the trailer that he moved into, and this was his workshop. This is a view of the trailer and workshop as it is today. NOAA lived in that trailer for a number of years until the county essentially condemned it because it was unpermitted. This was the first work that NOAA made. So I can go back. Oops. Sorry. All right, yeah. And it was called Sculpture Defined. That's what it looks like today. And that's what it looked like when it was made. Yeah. This is a video inside the trailer where Noah lived. You know, I took my father to meet Noah and my daughter. My father was born in 1920. And when Noah had guests, what he used to do, he used to bake a chicken, make some greens and some cornbread, et cetera. And that's what he was doing. And my father, Noah asked my father to do something. And my father responded to Noah, "Yes, sir." And I kind of like went, "What?" And for the rest of the day, my father called Noah, "Sir," even though he was born 3 years after Noah. It just showed that, you know, Noah didn't demand respect, he commanded respect. And it really kind of told me something about obviously my father, but also his relationship to Noah and the kind of the larger than life presence that Noah had. This is a picture of the founding members of the Noah Purifoy Foundation. There's Noah, Debbie Brewer, Sue Welsh, Mona Brooks, Ed Roche, and I think this is Paul Carlstrom, and that is Richard Kennedy the Smith, the founding president of the foundation. This is a video of the workshop as it was then when Noah was alive. And, you know, Noah moved to the desert when he was 72, but he was incredibly active. Most of the stuff he made was, you know, by himself. He did have some help, but he, you know, worked night and day, day and night. And, you know, it was really inspiring to see the dedication that Noah had to his work and his practice. And this is the workshop today, as it exists today. So here's a kind of a broad brush of the site and many of the pieces. I will now discuss a few of those pieces. But you can see how, you know, everything is out in the open. And as I said earlier, Noah considered the environment his collaborator. This has been an incredible issue and problem for the foundation is, you know, how to keep this work alive. And that's one of the things that we work on a, you know, continuous basis. Carousel was a piece that he made for one of his friend's kids. So when Noah moves out to the desert, you know, when he was in LA, you could just find stuff all over the place. But living out in the desert where everyone basically repurposes everything, that became a challenge and an issue, and it changed the way Noah collected material. But once people found out he was there, people began to come and give him things as well as him kind of going to flea markets and swap meets. White colored. Being African American, we have a lot more to be angry about, Noah says, than other people. I used art that way, but I always felt sensitive about it because it puts art in an awkward position. the creative process doesn't allow you to be angry too long. If you want to express anger, do it, but with the idea that you're going to overcome it. It ends up hurting you more than anyone else. Noah also emphatically denied that this work was protest art, insisting that he was only representing simple historical facts. Aurora Borealis. Aurora Borealis is an assembly hall built around a printer's plate of the first page of the Declaration of Independence that has been broken in half and suspended from the ceiling. A speaker's platform decorated with the stars and stripes of the national flag takes up one side of the room. Next to the platform is a fragment of a large stone sign that Purifoy had found sporting the words, "Today it's simple, convenient." And the reason it's called the Aurora Borealis is you can kind of see it. There's a wall that it has bottles in it. And you know, when the sun shines through those bottles, it looks very celestial in form. Ode to Frank Gehry. This was built, much to the chagrin of the California Afro-American Museum, with crates that held Noah's work from his first retrospective there. And that's actually where I first became aware of Noah in 1997. Frank Gehry subsequently donated 6 custom chairs to the foundation, which reside in the education center. And Noah said, "It's been said that I am a frustrated architect." And one of the, this also shows our conservation and preservation team working on kind of getting this piece back into shape. As you can imagine, this being out in the middle of the desert, the kind of abuse it takes from the environment, which is something that Noah was, you know, kind of okay with. Here's another view of Ode to Frank Gehry and a piece, 65 Emmeline Trays. The White House. So this piece was created to act kind of as a exhibition space where, you know, pieces would be put in and taken out on a regular basis. It's also important to note that because of the building requirements out in the desert, Noah didn't put a roof on this, because if there was a roof on it, it would have become an actual house, and therefore it would be required to have certain kind of permits to make it safe, et cetera. So he didn't put a roof on it for that reason. Collage. And I think collage is really one of the exemplary pieces for Noah's ideas about the creative process. It was initially created 30 by 60 feet as a flat piece that would take on the characteristics of a quilt. But as you can see, it's not flat. And it essentially took on a life of its own. And Noah's interest in the creative process was about, how do things actually happen? How does art happen? What happens to the artist and the idea and the material? And this is a really great example of the piece really taking on a life of its own. Sometimes an artist will have an idea and they will just try to push everything they can into that idea, even though it doesn't work. Some artists, on the other hand, have an idea, start pushing into something they think it's not working, and then they follow the idea versus trying to push the idea that they have into something that isn't really working. Noah was of the latter. He would follow the idea. None of these pieces had drawings. They were just kind of organically came together through Noah's interaction with the materials. Noah said, when I create something, it generally comes from my early childhood experiences in a world that is imperfect. And the title of this piece is from the point of view of the little people. You know, obviously it's a small child looking up at adults. Washerwoman. Adrian's little theater was a collaborative. Again, this, you know, shows Noah's collaborative process, which he continued, you know, throughout his making career. Quonset hut. Here, Noah goes back to his roots from his CB days of building Quonset huts in the South Pacific during the Second World War. These doors were a collaborative project with a number of artists in the area. And the Quonset hut serves as a gallery space for more discrete works that Noah has made. Many of these works were taken out of the trailer and out of the workshop. It's really important to note that, you know, one of the important aspects of the mission of the foundation is to, you know, bring Noah's work and life and his legacy to a larger group of people, which HAHS is definitely doing that for us. But in 2015, former board member Yael Lipschitz, in collaboration with Franklin Sermons at the Los Angeles County Museum, curated a retrospective of Noah's work. And they brought a couple pieces from the desert into the museum. But I mentioned this because very few people knew about Noah. And when they saw this work in the white box removed from the desert, it really showed Noah's knowledge of the history of art, the philosophy of aesthetics. And people were just blown away by it. In fact, the New York Times credited it as one of the top 10 shows of that year. And that exhibition really put some steam behind the foundation and also raising the level of awareness of Noah and his work. Shelter for the homeless is based on Noah's experiences as a social worker. Shelter for the homeless, shelter for everybody. If you remember, Governor Reagan threw all the crazy people out into the streets during his tenure. So this is a political statement. No, it is a social statement. Shelter also resonates with Purifoy's descriptions of structures from his childhood in Alabama. In back of where we lived was a corn mill, and they threw away burlap sacks which the corn came in. So I collected these burlap sacks, spread them out, and nailed them down underneath the house where we lived. And I had a place to retreat. With its desert floor covered in carpet rather than burlap, shelter feels perhaps like the retreat where he constructed for himself beneath his childhood home. Other aspects of the structure, such as the warped tin siding that Noah affixed to the eastern end of shelter, also suggests Snow Hill, where it was common to see old cabins and barns with roofs that are similarly pieced together in configurations that resemble rusting three-dimensional patchwork quilts. Noah also had an incredible gift of humor. And this piece behind the welcome sign is everything and the kitchen sink. This is just a kind of a brief overview of Noah's sculpture garden. This piece is called The Old Volks Back Home. It's like a Volkswagen hood here, and these are auto parts. The Kirby Express. Kirby being probably the best vacuum cleaner ever made, some still in use today. This is our visitor center, and inside we have a wealth of material about Noah, a few of his pieces, but a lot of publications. We have our Urban Arts Initiative program, which brings these kids out from South Central. We have a curriculum that conforms to the visual and performing arts standards of the state of California. They have an initial kind of lecture prior to the visiting the site. They come out to the site, we give them a healthy lunch. They have a windshield tour of Joshua Tree National Park, and then they go back and have an artist educator come into the class, and they work on materials that kind of thinking about Noah and reflecting on their experience there with Noah.
I had a lot of problems personally, but my race had more problems than I had. And in Watts, it struck me harder there than anywhere else where, there was physical evidence of these people struggling to overcome. And so that's where I thought art was the art process was the answer to some of our problems. When I was in art school, I ran across an artist named Marcel Duchamp. And he is the originator of what is called as is. In other words, A lot of things that we find and people make and throw away are really art forms as they are. You don't have to do anything to them. So I feel that if I can incorporate any number of pieces in a work and not destroy the image of any of them, then people can recognize the object and see it in relationship to another object, and probably relate to it better if they can recognize it. They feel that they have participated in one way or another.
Noah never tried to duplicate anything. He wanted to reflect the essence of things because they were a part of his existence. It was one of the reasons why he didn't draw from life. Purifoy purposely used perishable materials because he could see change in the work by allowing nature, the sun, wind, and rain to participate in the creative process. He believed that assemblage art is closer to existence than any other art form because the found objects are something people don't want and throw away, and he finds them and renews them, creating his outdoor museum of sculptures, installations, and constructions for public access and exploration. He made the open air environment accessible to all without fees or fences, contributing to the greater good of the communities it serves and all of its visitors. Purifoy wanted to establish rapport with his audience, be they students, scholars, art historians, or the general public. He said his only hope was that his effort inspired someone to go home and do what he or she really wants to do. Noah said he simply wanted to be known as an artist who made art for the sake of change, and who strove to understand art and its role in the world.
Thank you so much, Joe. So appreciate your time and energies in this presentation and sharing about Noah Purifoy's incredible life, work, and of course his ongoing legacy. We are gonna move into, running a little short on time, but there's some great questions in the Q&A, and I want to offer the opportunity for folks, if you do have a burning question, to put it in the Q&A and we'll try and get to it. But I do want to start with my own question. So I had the great pleasure of visiting the Outdoor Museum this past May with my family. I did not warn them what we were going into, but they all loved it, which was wonderful. And there was actually a lot of restoration work occurring while we were visiting. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about the ongoing conservation on the site and who supports that work, like artists or architects, community members. I'm kind of curious who has their hand in it.
Yeah, as I've said a couple of times, the work being out in the desert, out in the environment is really tricky for us as a group of people trying to preserve his legacy. Fortunately, we have one person on the board, John Baker, who is a well-known art fabricator, very high-end, And twice a year, he comes out and makes an assessment of which pieces need to be addressed first. And then, you know, we have our foundation friends come out, and he has a crew, and we come out and do it like once or twice a year and address the pieces that are most in need of conservation.
Wonderful. Yeah, I think they were working on Adrian's little theater while I was there.
Yeah.
Which, speaking of, Zoom glitched out a little bit when you were sharing about that particular piece. There was a collaborator on that work. Could you remind us who that was?
Yeah, Adrian Zeitel, artist, and she and Noah collaborated on that piece, and they did. She did performances in there, puppeteering.
Oh, incredible! That's right. Thank you. Someone was wondering if Noah sketched or planned pieces in advance, or was the assembly process a bit more improvisational?
The assembly process was, I would say, anchored to the creative process, and that was something that Noah was really involved with. So as I talked about in collage, you know, the work pretty much kind of took on a life of its own. So we did show one drawing of something of Noah's, but it was very unusual for him to draw anything out. He just kind of went out and started working.
Nice. Yeah, just let the spirit move, is what it sounds like. Someone was wondering if Noah's art was in any way influenced by living through the Great Depression, where, you know, there's a habit of people not throwing things away, hanging on to things during that era.
Noah was born in, you know, Snow Hill, Alabama in 1917. So, you know, that community was always in the Great Depression. You know, like,
yeah.
Sharecropping, you know, I mean, they, you know, and it's funny because my father was the same way, but he didn't grow up in that situation, but he never threw anything away. He always fixed something. So I'm sure that, you know, all of that had an effect on Noah and his relationship to the materials that he used.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. Someone was wondering at what age or ages did he complete his various degrees?
He was about right before his 40th birthday, he got his BFA. He got his MSW, let's see. Sorry, I should know this offhand, but I don't.
It's all good, yeah.
He got his undergraduate degree in 1939, and he received his MSW in 1948.
Perfect, thank you. Okay, one last question before we transition away. Someone wants to know if Noah ever married or had a family, any family that moved out with him, anything like that?
Well, he was part of a large family, but he never married.
Gotcha. Wonderful. All right. Well, once again, thank you to all our presenters here today and to our audience for joining us. Just as a reminder, this event is brought to you by the James Castle House, the Historic Artist Homes and Studios Program, and Noah Purifoy Foundation. A big thanks again to Valerie and to Joe and to Peter and to Christine, who was behind the scenes on so much of this, as Valerie mentioned earlier. I've gone ahead and plopped related events, resources, mailing lists, donation links into the chat, and we hope that you will explore those and, of course, join us next month as we continue this road trip. It's our last stop for this year. We're heading to Great Falls, Montana, to learn more about the home studio of the original cowboy artist, C.M. Russell. As a reminder, a recording of today's event will be made available online within the next week or so, and you can find this and all other HAHS road trip recordings on the James Castle House YouTube channel. And of course, we'd love to hear your feedback, your comments. If you have any additional questions, please reach out to us. We have quite a few contact emails in the chat as well, so please use those to connect. So once again, thank you everyone, and I hope wherever you are, you're having a wonderful day and the rest of your day is amazing. Thank you.
Thank you to HAHS and for everyone who joined us today, and Mackenzie and Valerie for your support. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Joe. We love having you in the HAHS family. Really love it. Love learning more about this today. And so glad that we could share this with everyone online today. Thanks.
All right. Have an amazing day, y'all.